Todlene Deferlin with a Sun TV News Brief. The National Health Insurance Plan has received some very strong and serious criticism about the unsatisfactory manner in which it treats residents of the Turks and Caicos Islands, especially Belongers. During the town hall meeting, which was organized by former Deputy Premier and Minister of Health, Lillian Boyce, under the patronage of her foundation, Sister TCI, persons in attendance gave heartbreaking stories about how they and their loved ones have been treated by NHIP. Chief among those who were criticized were CEO of NHIP, Zanita Burton, and Dr. Hamlet Nation, a Jamaican national who is in charge of overseas referrals. Karen Bonaby, an employee of Mizzix and Stanberg Law Firm, was one of those who called for the dismissal of Dr. Nation and Mistress Burton.
Because Turks Island is supposed to be better for us. We're not supposed to be living like third-class citizens in our own country. Because we can't go to Jamaica and do that. They'll find you on the side of the street.
That's right.
We can't go nowhere and do this. We can't do this. And I might as well tell you, Mr. CEO, Dr. Nation got to go. Don't just renew for the CEO, God help you.
That's true.
I seriously, God help you, you running for politics.
That's right.
I mean, in Turks Island, people, and if you go around here, everywhere, I mean, you can't even mention this woman's name, people won't fight you.
Okay.
I am so serious. I am so serious. And the government knows this because how many times I told the Premier about my situation? He totally ignored me. Huh? How many times I tell whoever in government, they totally ignore me. Huh? They totally ignore me like I was nobody.
The thing about it is this. Dr. Nation. This man has no concern for Turks and Caicos Islands people. The only concern he has is that he makes sure he showed the government that I can save you some money so I can stay here on a work permit and support my people in Jamaica.
That's right.
And trust me, I raided you that mistake.
She's posting.
What?
This is step one. That little
count that we need. The CEO has no concern for Turks and Caicos Islands people because she know she got the backing of the government and she will always be on a contract. So she don't care a hell about us. Because we gotta start from somewhere. You know why we gotta start somewhere? Because we got people who support these people in their ignorance. Because if they weren't supporting them in their ignorance, they wouldn't be able to do all this ignorance. Because all these cries, people got up with NHIP, and I'm so disappointed in Turks Island people because they just make a whole lot of noise, they got a whole lot of noise, and they don't bite. That's the reason why these people don't work from this and we call us stupid, call us all kinds of things, because they know the only thing we got mouth. And they know there is no way in hell we can go in their country and we be able to do these kind of things that they just do to us. You know, we people are so passive. We are passive people for the wrong reasons. And trust me, I tired. I mean, I enough is enough for me. Enough is enough. And you know, and all these things the government should be looking at.
Yes.
You understand? They're looking at pure foolishness. They ain't care about people. They ain't care about your health.
No.
They ain't care about your job.
No.
They ain't care if you're living or not.
No.
They ain't care. I might as well tell you they don't care. And God can allow me a platform to really deflate it.
Yes.
Because I am tired. I am tired of crying in my own country. I am tired, and we gotta stand up, we gotta start somewhere.
Bonaby explained the situation which she and her husband experienced in Jamaica while he was sick.
We went to Jamaica on a Tuesday. They set us up to go to Jamaica on a Tuesday, and we were supposed to come back that Monday. Phil says they gave Rupert $100 a day and they gave me $200
It didn't matter what that $200 could have done. But in Jamaica, they don't charge you Jamaican dollars for a hotel. You gotta pay US dollars, which was something like almost $100+ plus tax. So you had no room for nothing else. You had no room to buy food and so on and so on. So automatically there was an expense on me. I called the CEO's husband, who is my co-worker. He probably didn't answer his phone, so I WhatsApped him, and I told him the situation. So he probably got back to me, Marcy, later that morning or whatever. He said, well, he didn't see my email or so on and so on and so on. I said, did you speak to your wife or whatever? So he refused to answer. So I figured she was not trying to help me. I waited, Marcy, about two weeks, and I asked the CEO, because she's in and out of our office, like I said, because her husband works there. So I said to her, I have my stuff for you, the tickets that we didn't use, on American. I said, the tickets from Air Trux and Caicos, you know, you guys still have it because we didn't use them. So which means that I had already known that Inter Island had already refunded them for the tickets that we didn't use, the second half of the tickets. I already know that. So she rudely said to me, you had no rights to go through Miami. We don't send nobody through Miami, and it's not our policy to send anybody through Miami. So I'm like, we had permission from our caseworker that we could have done that because we were stuck. We were supposed to, what we were supposed to do. She had no rights to tell you that. She don't have any authority to do that. I'm like, but that was the only person that we were in contact with in Turks and Caicos. That was the only person that answered the phone. I was like, we tried to contact you and you wouldn't. Anyway, you're not going to get that back because it's not our policy to do so. So anyway, where I work, we believe in policies. So my boss said, he said, Karen, just for the principle that I would take this case on. So before that, I wrote to who was then the director, Mr. Drexel, on September the 1st. I waited until September the 1st. And I explained my case to him, and I told him what happened. So he said to me, well, he didn't get it. He said he would had a courier to bring it to him. So I waited and I waited weeks and weeks and weeks, weeks. Until October the 9th, when I wrote him again and I asked him, you know, about the refund for our tickets. Because, trust me, it wasn't the $700+. To me, it was just the principal. So he wrote me back and said, your information was forwarded to the CEO and the board, and the CEO would get back to you. I know she is currently away, but I will follow up. So I waited until weeks later, and I heard nothing from him. So I emailed him again, and I said, you know, I have not heard from the CEO, but isn't you the board? So he came back to me and said, yes, I am the chairman, but all responses, correspondence comes from the CEO. I said, okay, so I will wait on the CEO. I waited and waited until November. It was like the 9th of November. And I went back to him and I asked him, I'm like, you know, what happened to the refund? I mean, at least say something to me. So he said to me, I don't know about the status of your claim. I'm like, but you're supposed to be the board. And I sent my claim to the board. So he was like, you know, well, the CEO is supposed to get back to you. So anyway, I waited and I waited and I waited. And I keep pressuring him and keep pressuring him until he came back to me and he said, I acknowledge receipt of your email. There's nothing else I can do. As your request is not in line with our policy, you will be receiving a letter shortly from the CEO. My apologies for any inconvenience. We were up and down trying to find out, first of all, who was the person responsible and in charge of the appeals board, until finally we got to find out who the chairman was. And it was established that from the time the National Health Insurance came into effect, where they should have had a board in place, what the government did was they placed some people on the board to pay them every month, which was probably some of their supporters. But the board never had a meeting since the inception of NHIP.
Local businessman and contractor Phil Robinson, whose teenage son Phil recently had to undergo surgery for a brain tumor in Nassau, also spoke about how he had to beg to get NHIP to move his son from Princess Margaret Hospital to Doctors Hospital so he can get better treatment.
I beg and I plead before my child was moved from Princess Margaret into Doctors Hospital. I beg, literally beg. Okay, Nerys and Lillian, on this side begging. Charlene on this side begging. At one time, Ms. Taylor contacted me. So there were a number of persons on this side begging. I got an email from Dr. Ewing stating, I have instructed, these are the exact words, I have instructed Dr. Nation and the CEO at NHIP to have Phil move from Princess Margaret to Doctors. Okay, I got an email, so everything is good. I walk from Princess Margaret to Dr. Magnus' office, which is about two blocks, to pick up the transfer script and everything. Standing in the hallway, the admin officer from Doctors Hospital called. I just got off the phone with Dr. Nation, and he said he didn't give no such instructions. This is Dr. Nation
versus
the Minister of Health and the Premier. And I'm back on the phone again with, at this time now, I got a four-way call going on with Lillian, Keelan, Dr. Ewing, Hayden, everybody. Is on the phone, okay? And Dr. Nation is point blank, a stone wall. He is not moving. He is not budging. He is not budging. Back to Dr. Ewing, off the phone with him. Dr. Ewing spoke with the surgeon, and this thing is a stone wall for about another 2 to 3 hours. My child is in limbo, wondering if he's gonna be moved. Because why? Princess Margaret didn't have the facility even to do the MRI on the child head.
Wow.
So he would have to wait. This was the waiting process. He had to wait until Monday to do the MRI at a private facility in Nassau. And once that was done, then it would have been a scheduling for a surgery. So it would have not have been that same Wednesday. It would have been probably the following or the following week when it was availability. My honest opinion is that NHIP seek to write my son off. That was point blank, they're writing my child off. And we went to doctors, the MRI was done that very night at 9 o'clock. I have the pictures to show the tumor my child had, big tumor. The surgeon said, I can't wait until 24 hours pass. I have to go in now. So by 9 o'clock the following morning, Phil was prepped for surgery.
Imagine
waiting a week or two. corpse. Thanks be to God for every person that fought on this side. But the mercies of God and His love and mercy towards us, Phil did the surgery, came out, and he's doing well by God's grace and mercy right now. But that's my part. I fought. I had some family members that fought with me. But there are some people out there who don't have it. Okay? Let me mention my subsistence. There is no subsistence for a person who goes directly into a hospital overseas. But there is $200 given to the person who goes along to a company.
If they're paying
NHIP. If the NHIP is up to date.
If they are
paying. Yeah, the person, if I'm paying, is up to date. They will give me $200 to go along accompanying the patient.
What?
$200. I don't care if you're in Nassau for 100 weeks.
$200.
As long as that individual is in the hospital, that person don't get a subsistence to buy a juice or fruit.
Wow.
They're in the hospital, so they don't need the subsistence. When they come out, they'll give them $100 a day. Regardless of the country you're in, $100 a day you will get. To move around, food, and live. Unless we are willing to revolutionize the system, unless we are able to stand up and demand that the government make changes and make changes now, we're going to lose more of our citizens. We're going to lose more of our loved ones.
Former Deputy Premier and Minister of Health, Lillian Boyce, also spoke about her bad experience with NHIP, where she was first denied health, then discriminated against, and finally had to end up paying for a portion of her own health care in the USA, although she was fully paid up with NHIP.
They send us to places that cannot help us, and then we are sick. We get worse. And a lot of our loved ones come back in body bags. Now, that may have not happened to you, but it happened to us twice. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like I was given enough warnings, but again, I still did nothing about it. I was refused. What about others, so many others? While this meeting is not about me, but why it's important to tell my story, it will show you that if they refuse me, they will continue to refuse others among us. I was referred to Jamaica, and Dr. Perry, and I have everything in writing, I have them in emails. Dr. Perry said to NHIP that my surgery could not be done in Jamaica. So I asked to be sent to the Bahamas because I have lots of families there. I would be very comfortable. She said my surgery could not be done in the Bahamas. And then they knew it had to be done in the US. However, I had proof at that time, and I shared it with NHIP that there were other Turks and Caicos Islanders presently at that time in Jackson Memorial doing the very said surgery that I should have got, although it was due to take. So then the CEO of NHIP said that they will send me to Puerto Rico instead, where I couldn't speak the language, where I had no families to visit me, but she just meant it was not gonna be in the USA. We had to refuse that because I wasn't familiar with many of our people going on to Puerto Rico. And I'm thankful to be alive, but I do have some medical issues that I continue to manage and investigate. The doctors continue to, and it all stemmed from, in fact, the doctor said to me, no human being should live this way. When I finally got into Holy Cross and was about to do the surgery. Now, how do I bring this all home? See the picture with me. I wrote my niece obituary, Raquel Morley, when she died. A part of her obituary was mentioning to our healthcare system, to the doctors, that they refused her referral abroad. She needed that checkup, Raquel, and they refused it. And that was a part of her obituary. I wrote it and I read it. And she died. They just planned that they were not going to spend any more money on Raquel. And they refused her. Then I did not speak out a lot about my Uncle Porter, but I remember telling the premier at the hospital, Porter, used to share Porter as uncle, both of our uncle. And I said, Mr. Premier, bypass surgery in Jamaica. If Porter die, I point at all of us, the sisters, you have all of us to deal with, because we were fearful of him having a bypass surgery in Jamaica. We had enough proof of almost everyone who went to Jamaica. They came back in a body bag after the bypass surgery, the same bypass surgery, so we had our fears. And Porter died from something very simple in Jamaica. But I always lay that at the foot of his children. I say, if y'all are not going to speak for him, I'm not going to.
Mistress Boyce said it was shocking that certain persons at NHIP and in the healthcare system were refusing to carry out the instructions of the premier, who is also Minister of Health.
So together we are going to compile our demands for the premier, who is our Minister of Health. See, he's a very important person. You can't get tired of me talking about him. He is the boss of the country. That was one of the things I said to him when Dr. Nation refused to follow his instructions. I said, you are the boss of this country. How can Dr. Nation belittle you and say he's not going to do? But you know, I'm not a fool. I'm thinking in the background that Dr. Nation must be empowered to do so. Exactly. He couldn't be so strong to, you know, feel that he can do it.
Trust me.
How could the CEO be so strong in her conviction that she's not going to do something? You are the boss of this country, and you are the Minister of Health. So even though you think I buy the foolishness that I give them instructions, you are the boss of this country. Will you let them disrespect you that way?
Former Youth Ambassador Nafsky Bean also attended the meeting and had this to say.
It doesn't take that much to provide standard health care. And these people don't know that the people that are hurting, their fathers, their sons, you know, their husbands. And they need to understand that what they're doing affects other people.
Human Resource Manager Melanie Smith also made a passionate speech about the problems with NHIP and the healthcare system. She also spoke about how her sister, Barbara Lee Johnson, has been treated by the NHIP.
I'm standing in the gap as well for Mr. Quick, who is currently away seeking medical attention. I was not able to visit him, but like Phil said, he saw him, and so he knows his condition even better than I do. But speaking with my aunt, who had to fly in from Florida to take care of him, because that's who we have. Dr. Nation and Dr. Rufus is already consulting since last week. to send him back home. And my thoughts about that is, if he was sent away because we couldn't help him, why send him back within 3 weeks? Someone who's living with half of his skull in his stomach at the moment, and he's paralyzed to his left side, continuously praying that he'll get better, and they're looking to send him back home. Chairman, I'm not there, but I told my aunt, Patricia Rigby, hell no, fight. Fight, okay, because he's within the fourth week, and before they write another check, they're looking to send him back to Providenciales to be in the hospital for maybe a week, and then they will ask for their bed. No, I'm standing on his behalf today. I have a sister, and her name is Barbara Aretha Johnson. Everybody know her, and they did injustice to her.
Big injustice.
She is sitting to sing, because she has two bad knees. It's probably 3 to 4 years that she went on national TV asking for assistance. Okay? Very, very sore. Just for a referral.
Just for referral.
For her to get some help. Okay? I mean, it is so bad right now that she is preparing for another surgery, which will be surgery number 3 out of her pocket. And what I want to bring up front right now, because you are here and because all of us work, and NIB and NHIP is the first deduction from our salaries before we get a meal. Okay? When I look at the number and the dollar amount that is deducted on a monthly basis,
exactly,
the care that we get is unacceptable.
And you even use it, most of us.
Unacceptable. And I'm telling you, and that's why this thing is so big. That's why we have so many employees using sick days. They're just calling out. Okay, so it's a circle, and people don't understand how tight we are. Okay?
Opposition leader, Honorable Charlene Cartwright Robinson, was almost moved to tears as she spoke about the many sad stories she has been hearing about the NHIP.
I haven't been given the release for some other stories that I wish I could share, but this is one that intends to take action, and I'm at liberty to say it this evening to you. There was a young lady that was having a bleeding problem for weeks and weeks and weeks, literally, over in Grand Turk. She went to the hospital. You do know that the hospital, there was a doctor that didn't want to deal with her. There's another doctor that was very kind. You do know that a request for referral was made. We don't know what happened since then. I was at the hospital, I left the House of Assembly, went to the hospital there with her, a Dominican national, married to a very good friend of mine. We got nothing back from NHIP. Her husband decided the very next morning, went to the hospital back that evening, of course, sent home again, but he decided the next morning that he was going to fly her to the DR himself. She got into the DR, and the next day she was on this list, waiting for a referral. Assist that person out. And that, for me, was one of the worst stories I had heard. Because there she was, saying that I have all this problem. We're waiting on the referral, we're waiting for NHIP to get back, and there is nothing. That's as recent as last week. One of the other policies that persons don't speak about, maybe it is a policy, maybe it isn't, but this is what's told a young man that traveled to the DR when his brother was ended up being fatally stabbed. He traveled to the DR with his brother, and his brother was not really responsive as he should be, but he knew when someone was there or not. So it was a very tough decision. He did go along with his brother. He was not working, so he was not paying him to end him. The brother, of course, was sent for the care, but the one who went along got nothing. He could not stay with his brother the time he needed to, and on the day that he decided that I can't afford to stay any longer and that another brother will come in and relieve me, that brother died alone. He died alone in the Dominican Republic, and that is a story that the family really is distraught over, because of the fact that there was no coverage. He had to look after his brother to basically die alone. The next act for me was an act of wastage, where it was for me personally. traveled with a loved one to the Bahamas on Sunday for a 9 o'clock appointment on Monday, only to be told that the test that I'm going for was not until Friday. It was only done on Fridays. I'm saying that to give you three bits of advice. You need to know the facility. Right now, there's a 10-year-old that I promised my voice that I would give her husband his story, who has cancer. His mother's Jamaican, his father's from Grenada. She doesn't speak Spanish, the doctors don't speak English. They're in the DR trying to understand each other. I don't have to go any further than that. The father was there, he got a little bit outrageous. Of course, you know, he's a little bit more passionate. He was brought home. He told him he couldn't stay because he was not just satisfied with what was going on in his son. You need to know the facilities. I applaud to be able to communicate with the doctors. You need to know the services that they offer. There must be somebody that can vouch. And Mr. Chairman, we have to have caseworkers. If you're sending people to facilities overseas, there must be somebody working on our behalf.
The opposition leader said the NHIP and healthcare system are broken and need to be fixed.
Our healthcare system is broken. The hospital is broken. The NHIP is broken. It needs to be fixed. It is costing us, forget the monies right now, it is costing us in lives and in health. And I say that to you with the utmost respect. I brought a private member's motion more than a year ago. And the private member's motion was crafted in a way that it did not have to go to a political office. It was crafted that the House of Assembly makes recommendation to the Speaker to tell the governor to investigate the health care. It is stuck on the desk. While our people are dying, they're getting worse, and we're losing millions. Problem is, nobody's paying attention.
Sabrina Green, who is running as an independent candidate in the upcoming election, said the NHIP is failing the people of the Turks and Caicos Islands, and it is time to put some pressure on the institution.
I want to put InterHealth and NHIP on notice that you got some barking dogs out here in the street today, and these dogs get teeth and they can bite. And if I am encountering more and more people on a daily basis that are coming forward about their healthcare concerns and the rules that they face in this country, it's going to be exposed.
Yes.
And I am waiting on the day when we have this demonstration because these people want to be a part of it.
Yes.
There are so many people. The names are so numerous to mention. I mentioned this lady case because it was so grave to see that the doctors in Jamaica told her, another week in Turks and Caicos and you would be dead. I honestly feel NHIP would be happy with that because that's another one off their horse. But if you look around here in this country and you see the people who are getting maltreated in the healthcare industry, it's us.
It's us
ending up in the body bags. It's us right now can't get healthcare because of situations they let lay and go by for so long that it becomes terminal.
That's right.
We are an endangered species in our country. We're dying daily because of a healthcare system that is failing us.
Yes.
During my tours throughout the country, I've met so many people who are encountering so much struggles when it comes to the healthcare industry in this country. And it appears really as though no one actually cares. No one cares. Your loved ones are sent down to the slaughterhouse, I call it, where they lay there forever until it's time for them to die. That's when they evacuate them out of the country to the Dominican Republic and Jamaica, and they come back in body bags. This is real, real unfortunate. But what I want to bring to your attention tonight is a situation that I've encountered when I was in Grand Park 2 weeks ago. I saw someone that I knew from my neighborhood very well. And I could see the difference in her facial appearance. The chin was disfigured. And I asked her, I said, what is going on with your face over here? She says, from the injury I had over 20 years, I'm still feeling pain from this chin. I said, so did you go to the doctor? She says, I've been up and down to the doctor's Brenner for over 4 months now with this pain in my chin, and all they are continuously giving me is antibiotics. I say, you've been on antibiotics for over 4 months? She said, yes, over 4 months.
I said, so who is the person you're dealing with? She gave me the individual's name at the hospital. I looked at her, I said, girl, how are you surviving? She says, well, I went over to the doctor, to a private doctor, and they said that the infection from the gum is already spreading to my brain.
What?
So I contacted the lady at InterHealth. I said, something has to be done for this woman. She is up all night with excruciating pain. She says the infection is going so far now that sometimes she's a bit senile because the fever and everything is going to her head. The lady at InterHealth said to me, she says, oh, but Sabrina, you know, NHIP don't cover dental. I said, are you seriously telling me you still consider this woman's problem to be a dental issue? I said, so if the infection left from her jaw, gone to her brain, should that not be another medical concern that should be on your books? She says, well, I guess if you put it like that, and I just couldn't get over her attitude, how nonchalant it was, you know? Well, I guess if you put it like that, I guess we can send her back. Ask her to go to the emergency room. She said, but what you need to understand is she has a pre-existing condition, eh? The lady went back to the hospital, sent her to NHIP. They said they have to send her out of the country immediately. She left Turks and Caicos 2 weeks ago, and she called me back from Jamaica. She's washed away in tears on the phone. She said, Brenna, I have cancer in my jaw. I said, what do you mean you have cancer in your jaw? She said, those people was leaving me in Grand Turk to die. I have cancer. They have to remove every teeth out of my mouth right now to get to the cancer. She just came out of a 13-hour surgery yesterday. Well, I'm saying this to say, what if Betty didn't have a Sabrina she could have run to? What if she didn't have someone who could stand in the gap and stand up and represent her interests? How many other individuals are like her here in this country who feel they have no one to turn to because we're dealing with a healthcare system that just don't give two hoots about us and our well-being? I am waiting on the day when we have this demonstration because these people want to be a part of it. There are so many people. The names are so numerous to mention. I mentioned this lady case because it was so grave to see that the doctors in Jamaica told her, another week in Turks and Caicos and you would be dead. I honestly feel NHIP would be happy with that because that's another one off their books. But if you look around here in this country and you see the people who are getting maltreated in the healthcare industry, it's us.
It's us
ending up in the body bags. It's us right now can't get health care because of situations they let lay and go by for so long that it becomes terminal.
That's right.
We are an endangered species in our country. We're dying daily because of a healthcare system that is failing us.
Yes.
This woman pays into the scheme, and she was not given the opportunity to get proper healthcare where they could have probably dealt with the situation before it reached to the stage that it is today. So I'm saying to NHIP, you have to do better.
Yes.
We're not asking you for a favor. These are people who are paying into the scheme,
right,
and they should get value for dollar. They should get access to proper healthcare. And please be mindful of the fact that we will not require it anymore.
Okay.
The days of Turks and Caicos Island is sitting down and just accepting their fate. Those days are over. There are a new breed of people rising up today, and we are standing in the gap for our brothers and sisters, and we're gonna tear down some doors and we're gonna fight for them.
Guys.
It's that simple.
Yeah.
Thank you.
NHIP Chairman, Attorney at Law, Mark Fulford, said he was touched and concerned about the many stories he had heard from people at the meeting.
And talking about these stories gets me very emotional, so I'm trying to take my time. But when I accepted the chairmanship of NHIP, I did so with a personal conviction, feeling that I could do better, and I could help, and I could try and steer the board into the right direction, taking into account some of the weaknesses in the system that needs to be fixed. And so tonight I'm very grateful to have been invited here to come and hear firsthand some of the issues that the users of NHIP go through or feel, because too often sometimes we just sit in our lofty offices and think that everything is going well or the system is working in the way in which it intended. And so tonight I have had a serious amount of stories that need fixing. There are some good stories out there. There are also some access to benefits that the public don't know about. And so one of the key things that I would like to see done under my tenure as chairmanship is better publication to the public of what benefits that they can access, as well as to take on board some of the stories, some of the real life pain that people feel, to try and change that, or to try and make it easier. I know they like to say that finance is a concern, but we have to get back to looking to save lives rather than looking to save dollars.
Exactly.
That's it for now from Sun TV News. Thanks very much for watching. Until next time, I'm Todney Dufferlin. We'll be right back.